जय हिंद, सत श्री अकाल, नमस्कार, प्रणाम, आदाब सभी लोगों को। सबसे पहले आई वुड लाइक टू हैव वन अनाउंसमेंट। आई एम ग्लैड टू एक्सटेंड ए वेरी वार्म वेलकम टू रोटेरियन बिल, हु इज आवर पार्टनर फॉर द ग्लोबल ग्रांट प्रोजेक्ट द होप एंड हीलिंग सेंटर, हु हैज जॉइंड अस इन टुडेज मीटिंग। ए वेरी वार्म वेलकम to Julia also, who will be joining shortly. Friends, the Rotary Club of Sevenal County South Host Club is doing a global grant to support the Hope and Healing Center in Sanford, Florida. The Hope and Healing Center is a residential treatment facility and intensive outpatient program. In addition to mental health and medication, assisted treatment patient will also be supported with service that addresses their education, vocational, behavioral, and housing needs upon discharge. This project is basically for purchase of equipment for the center, total value of $39,268. Rotarian Rohit Jirazani is primary contact member in this wonderful project. Thanks, Rohit, for arranging this project, and thanks, Julia and Bill, for making it happen. Quickly, I would like to invite Rotarian Prerna Gaikwal, Secretary Rotary Club of Pune Riverside, for Secretary announcement. Over to Prerna.
A very good morning, everyone. Welcome, Julia. We have our power-packed duo, Neeruji and Anilji, who have their anniversary on the 11th of March, and they share it with Aditya and Shruti Mishra. So here's a very happy wedding anniversary to both of you in advance. Thanks all for this week. Thank you, Colonel. Back to you.
Thank you very much.
Colonel, I want to announce that I will be supporting this Goyan project fully on my own, which we have to get some information on this anniversary day to the club.
Oh, that's great. Please give very big hand to Neeruji. This is a project which was initiated by Ganesh Natarajan, and project cost is 3,60,000. In next meeting, I will give complete details. So, hats off for Neeruji.
Thank you.
It's really very auspicious occasion and very great announcement. Thank you very much.
Julia has joined. Please welcome her.
I'm so sorry, everyone. Misunderstood the days. I thought it was tomorrow night.
No problem. Most welcome. Most welcome. We were told that you are in chat. So, in fact, I requested Bill that you text a message to her. She can join in between also. So, we are very proud to be associated with you with a global grant project, which is really very nice, you know, the Hope and Healing Center. And the project cost is very, you know, it's a really 39,268, and I was told that it's almost ready. So quickly, can I request you to please throw light on that in 2 minutes over this project? So over to Julia.
Absolutely, thank you, everyone, and I apologize for not being on earlier. The Hope and Healing Center is a program facility that is really kind of revolutionary for us, where we're taking a community look at the opioid crisis and pulling our resources together in the community. So we have partnerships with Advent Health, which is the hospital, local hospital that is managing the facility. The Sheriff's Department is who really was the organization that brought this to Advent Health in the local community, because it takes a village to help people overcome addiction. And that's the purpose of it. So we felt very much aligned to support that effort by providing this global grant that will help cover the costs of some of the materials, the bedding and the furniture in the facility. Once it's launched this week, I sent the video of it. And as we watch to see how the recovery program goes, I have a feeling this will be expanded to other areas. So we appreciate your partnership on that. And we reached out to local clubs in our area to help raise that DDF funding to get to that point. And we actually exceeded, which we're ecstatic about. So So we're at the area that we're waiting to get fully finalized and get approval from the Rotary Foundation. So thanks very much. Does anyone have any questions?
Thank you, Julia. Thank you very much. Thank you. Before proceeding further, this today's session is interactive session, and we have two topics, and the speaker is Rotarian Mukesh Malhotra. He's senior active Arts Club Society member. I have shared a complete brief profile while creating the Zoom meeting invite link, so I will request you please go through. But few things which I would not like to miss. You know, he is a very well decorated esteemed member of the Rotary. I would like to mention few things. That is, he is the charter member of the Rotary Club Pune and its president long back. Member of Rotary Club of Pune, main Rotary Club of Pune Central. Before joining Rotary Club of Pune Riverside, and he is also charter member of Rotary Club of Pune Riverside. So please give very big hand to Mukeshji. It's we are proud and we are really associated with you. You are friend, philosopher, and guide as far as Rotary Club Pune is concerned. So not taking much time, I would like to invite you. Floor is yours. Please take on. Over to Mukeshji.
Thank you, friends. Good morning, everybody. Lovely to be with all of you again. I wish this was a physical meeting and we could have actually met each other, but this is the next best thing, so let's make the most of it. See, what I'm trying to get across today is really in the form of a little bit of a provocative thinking. I'm talking about some subjects which are of great importance to all of us. And I think that, I want to throw a few thoughts, provocative thoughts at you and see how, set your thinking hats on and see what you think about that. The first one that I wanted to talk about was global warming and climate change, which I don't think I need to stress is probably the most important issues of the 21st century. It's almost an existential kind of crisis that we're going to face. And I believe that, don't get me wrong, I believe that, all-out efforts are necessary to reduce carbon emissions by means of clean and green mechanisms, use of renewable energy and all that. But in my opinion, these measures and the tremendous costs, both financial and social, that they entail and they impose, don't provide a real solution and only delay the irreversible climate change. So what we really need to be looking for is something that is more permanent, something that is more ensured, and something that will actually, reverse the effects of climate change. So just to give you a few numbers and, to give you the scale of the problem, we emit approximately 51 billion tons of carbon, billion, not million, 51 billion tons of carbon into the atmosphere every year. Now, we had a sort of nice situation in one way that because of COVID, worldwide economic activity really slowed down. And because of that, almost the world came to a halt for some time. But in spite of that, this year, we will be releasing about 48 or 49 billion tons of carbon instead of 51 billion. So, and to get this reduction of 5%, tens of millions of people have been put out of work. We've created a huge amount of economic difficulties. And, we've just about dropped 5%. So this is proof that we can't get to zero emissions or get to this thing just by flying or driving less, as most of us think it is. We need new tools for climate change to fight it. We need zero carbon waste to produce electricity, which I think is one of the most important things. We need zero carbon waste to make things, to keep our buildings warm and cool, and to move people and goods around the world. And most important to my mind is we need ways to remove the greenhouse gases that we put into the atmosphere. We need to get them out of there. It's gigantic, something never done before, but I think we need to do it. I just want to give you an idea of, most of us think that it's our cars and aeroplanes, which are the real, culprits as far as emissions are concerned. Actually, I have this chart. I don't know how to show it to you guys, but let me see if this makes any sense. I don't know if you can see it, but anyway, let me explain. Making things like cement, steel, plastic, and things like that actually emits 31%, which is the largest single number. Electricity, the producing, the generation and transmission of electricity, produces 27% of the emissions. Growing things, agriculture, plants, animals, you know, things like that, produce 19%. Getting around, which is cars, planes, trucks, and ships, all told, is only 16%. And keeping warm and cool, refrigeration, air conditioning, heating, etc., is the other 7%. So really speaking, out of 51 billion tons, moving around is only 16%, which is hardly about 8 or 9 billion tons. All the real big things are when you manufacture things like cement, steel, plastic, and especially when you you know, have electricity. Now, there's an important paper written by economist Isabel Galeana, and she came to the conclusion that present policies designed to reduce emissions of greenhouse gases are failing and cannot be effective until better technology is available. You know, despite the Kyoto Protocol, the Paris Agreement, and everything, the fact is that emissions have actually increased 50% since 1990. And all the conservation measures are just not producing any real results. And let me give you an idea of what these kind of measures are actually going to cost the world. The International Energy Agency has said that investments of $44 trillion through 2030 are needed to decarbonize only the energy sector, that is generation and distribution of electricity. This spending is required to limit the average temperature rise to 2 degrees, which is what we want. So looking at you know, these figures and these numbers, you know, I really don't think that just conservation and mitigation are going to solve the problem. The two most important and critical areas to focus on are getting technology breakthroughs. Are one is clean, non-intermittent electricity. Today, our renewable energy, whether it's the sun, whether it's the wind, you know, and also to some extent water, gives us intermittent electricity, which means that if you want it to be regular and, you know, every time you press the button and you switch on, you get electricity, you need to either store it or you need carbon-based, fossil fuel-based electricity to supplement it. That's one. And number two, which I think is even more important, is the removal of carbon dioxide or the greenhouse gases from the atmosphere. You know, we must realize that even though electricity currently only is 27% of the problem, if we get a good, clean method of getting intermittent, non-intermittent, you know, electricity, we could shift away from burning hydrocarbons for manufacturing, for cooling, heating, and transportation. So if we get clean electricity, we can solve almost about 60-70% of the problem, whereas anything else would only solve 20-25%. Now, in terms of generating electricity, you know, there are some figures that fossil fuels require just a few, you know, 500 to 1,000 watts per square meter, whereas wind and solar give you only 5 to 20 watts per square meter. So the amount of land required for solar and wind is really humongous. I mean, we would probably use about half our land mass that we have in order to be able to produce enough solar energy and enough wind energy. And then it's intermittent because at night there is no sun and we can't get energy. So I think one of the things is that we might have to look at safe nuclear energy, you know, if that's this thing, because without that, I don't think we're going to have, unless we do something else. And that is where the challenge lies. As I said, that even if all human activity could somehow be brought to a standstill, there are many natural causes such as degradation of organic matter, agriculture, the gaseous expulsions of cattle and animals, which continue to put methane and carbon dioxide into the air, and which is impossible to control or stop. Hence, the buildup of carbon emissions is going to continue, even if we just sort of, you know, stopped the world. All scientific agencies are agreed on one fact, that once greenhouse gases cross the level of 450 parts per million, climate change effects are going to become irreversible and beyond human control. It is estimated that currently we are approaching the 415 parts per million mark, which is more than 90% of the 450 mark. And scientific estimates suggest that greenhouse gases during the pre-industrial revolution era were about 250 to 280 parts per million. So we have 10 to 15 years at current rates of emissions to breach the 450 parts per million limit, and we need to get down to 350 parts at least. And I think we've seen that it's really difficult by doing just conservation measures alone are not going to solve our problem. You know, also we've seen that it's very difficult and practical for the countries of the world to agree who should reduce carbon emissions and by how much. Emerging and developing country like ours want developed countries to carry a higher burden because they have achieved their development on the basis of very high energy utilization and leading to the higher carbon emissions by them for almost two centuries. The developed world, on the other hand, wants emerging countries to cut down even their meager utilization because on an absolute and total basis, they are bigger polluters. I mean, on a total basis, India may be a bigger polluter or China is a bigger, but on a per capita basis, we are much lower, you know. So agreement on these things is probably going to be impossible according to whatever goes on and the politics of the world, you know. And I don't think it's going to be possible to get everyone to agree how and who's going to go into this thing. So I think we should probably, you know, put our minds on spending substantial amounts of monies, far less than mitigation, far less than that $244 trillion that I just spoke about, to an international project mandated with task of finding economical, efficient, and practical means of carbon sequestration, which appears to be the only real solution to the problem of global warming and climate change. You know, on their own, all the other steps are short-term palliatives and will only postpone the inevitable. It's only by getting the greenhouse gases, which we have already put into the atmosphere over the last two centuries, out, and by bringing down the CO2 content to below 300 parts per million, that we can actually permanently ensure the survival of our planet and our economies as we see them today. You know, I'm aware that the science and technology of carbon sequestration or removing direct air capture, as they call it, you know, is very, very in its infancy. But there are some green shoots available. There are people doing some exotic research in the field of removing CO2 from the atmosphere by means of plants of the Azolla species, which suck CO2 out of the atmosphere. Seagrass that grows within the oceans, is another area which takes in 20 times the carbon dioxide that a normal plant does. And there's lots of algae, biofuels based on algae, which can do it. There's also work being done on asphalt which traps carbon dioxide. There's a very interesting negative emission center at the University of Arizona, which is carrying out cutting edge research. It has produced artificial trees, which can absorb CO2 from the atmosphere, but it costs about $100 per CO2 ton extracted. The technology is scalable and presents a valuable starting point for further advancements. You know, this direct air capture, removing carbon dioxide from the air, is expensive and unscaled, but if we can find a way to make it work at a large scale, it would allow us to capture the carbon dioxide when and wherever it is produced. Just to give you this thing, how it would cost, as today, we already know that the emission is about 51 billion tons. Currently, the cost, as per the University of Arizona, is $100 per ton. But with research and innovation, I'm sure it can come down to maybe $40, $50 per ton. So that tells us that we need to spend about $2.5 trillion a year in order to be able to remove all of the emissions that we put into the air. Now, remember, we don't need to remove all of it, because quite a bit of it can be removed by conservation measures or reduced by conservation measures. So maybe we need to remove only 20 or 30 billion tons instead of 51 billion tons. It's a small amount, but just remember that it's much cheaper than shutting down the economy, as we've done during this COVID pandemic. You know, in the US, there's a Rhodium Group, a think tank, they've come to a calculation that the per ton cost to the economy came to $2,600 to $3,000, whereas in the European Union, it was more than $4,000 per ton. So spending $25 or $30 or $40 per ton versus, you know, costing us $4,000 or $3,000 a ton. I mean, the maths is easy. I leave it to you guys. And this is where we really need better technologies to bring this cost down to $15 or $20 per ton to become really feasible and adaptable all over the world. You know, it's only of late that people like Bill Gates and you know, Elon Musk and Richard Branson have put their money where their mouth is. And they've all been investing large sums of money in either new technologies to remove carbon dioxide from the air, or Elon Musk, for instance, announced recently a carbon removal price of $100 million for the best technology innovations over the next 4 years. So, I mean, these are things that are happening, but I personally believe that this private initiative of a few hundred million dollars each is not really going to work or give us the results that we need. One area is removal of carbon dioxide from the air, and the other one is to find cheap green hydrogen. I think the real fuel of the future is hydrogen, because hydrogen, when burned, gives you just water vapor, and that's absolutely innocuous, absolutely harmless. There's no carbon involved. And so if you can find clean electricity to split water into hydrogen and oxygen, and then convert that into hydrogen fuel, which you can move around, you can ship around, et cetera. And believe me, there's a lot of work going on in hydrogen fuel cells, including in our own city, where KPIT, Mr. Ravi Pandit's company, has actually produced a prototype car which runs on hydrogen fuel cells. And that is just the beginning. And I think that's where I think a lot of investments must go. We need a plan to develop power grids that provide affordable, zero carbon electricity whenever needed. You know, if there's one single thing apart from direct air capture that could change the whole scenario, is clean, green electricity. Safe nuclear energy is another option which we must explore. Unfortunately, it's got a very bad rap, although it's like air crashes and car crashes. You know, when a plane crashes, 300 people die at one time, so it becomes a lot of news. Whereas the 500 crashes that take place every day, which kill almost the same number of people every day, you know, in a car, doesn't become news because it's one, two people at a time. So that's where I think this nuclear energy is going. And if somebody could come up with better methods. So these are the two or three areas where technology needs to be developed in order to actually create lasting solutions for our, you know, emissions problem and the climate change. And I think we have enough innovative brain power in this world, which is supported by adequate resources, can come up with desired workable solutions in a time frame. I mean, just remember, we, the Americans, had the Manhattan Project in the 40s. They came up with the atom bomb. Then they had the Man on the Moon project in the 60s, and they actually put a man on the moon. So, I mean, if you, there's adequate resolve, political will, and believe me, I don't think it's going to cost more than $200-300 billion to come up with technological solutions in these two or three areas. And if we put in our best brains from all over the world, and today you don't even need to put them in a single lab like they did in Los Alamos for the Manhattan Project. You can have virtual labs, people cooperating virtually and creating technological breakthroughs. And I'm sure that within the next few years, if adequate attention is given to that and enough public demand, you know, enough public thing is made where we ask the governments to look into these things, because all the other things are not going to work, I think it can be done. You know, just a small fraction of that $44 trillion that's required could solve our problems. And I think it's something that we really ought to be doing. Just to give you an example, there is the CERN, the Hadron Giant Collider Boson God Particle in Geneva, a project which has had many countries cooperate, almost 30 or 40 countries cooperate and fund a project, you know, which is not of that importance as a project for finding ways to remove carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases from the air, because that, you know, affects everybody, each one of us. And the important thing is that unless we do this, you know, the poorer countries and the poorer people in the world will never be able to achieve their growing aspirations. It's absolutely imperative that we find, we look at technology. I mean, it's we humans who have put the carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases in the air. And I think it's our responsibility to get it out of there and make the world a livable place again. So this is my thoughts on, layman's thoughts on what it, and all these facts and figures that I've given you, I can send you articles if you like. You can read them and you can understand where I'm coming from. Ganesh, you have a question, please. I'll try to answer. I'm not an expert.
More of a comment, Tony. And first of all, thank you. I think you really covered the ground extremely well in a very complex topic. But two points. So in one, in fact, my son-in-law was one of the scientists of in CERN, the whole Higgs boson project. So he and I keep having these conversations. Mm-hmm. See, the only problem is that in a country like ours, especially when you look at, I mean, fuel prices are going up. So this could be a great opportunity for us to look at alternative energy. I also checked the what's called the Connected and Electric Vehicles Project of Government of India. But if you look at the realities of going away from regular fuels and towards hydrogen cells, et cetera, et cetera, today 85% of car batteries, EV batteries are made in China. And we all know our current relationship with China. So my worry is it's going to take 3, 4, 5 years before we have the alternative technologies available to ensure that, you know, methane emissions and the kind of pollution of the world is going to come down. So I'm saying we probably have to balance against availability, development, and of course, the absolute imperative for climate change. So I don't know whether you had any thoughts on that.
You know, actually, I personally think that electrical vehicles, which are becoming such a rage just now. Firstly, as I said, you know, moving people around only does about 16 or 17%, you know, of the thing. So it's not really the sole answer to our solution. On the other hand, with electric vehicles, what you're really doing is shifting the pollution or the emission from the tailpipe to the smokestack, to the chimney of the power station. Because that is where that pollution is getting out. That's where the CO2 gases are coming out. So this is a stopgap. So unless we have, that's why I said, unless we have, you know, some means of creating clean, green energy, unless 70, 80, 90% of our power comes from, you know, green sources, whether it's biofuels, whether it's air, the wind, whether it's solar, nuclear, or hydrogen, which I think is eventually, which is why I feel that the electrical vehicle battery-based technology is really an interim technology and the real or a transitional technology. And the real solution will be when we get to hydrogen based fuel. You know, that is the real answer. That will be the final answer, at least for the time being. I'm sure there'll be better answers in future because man never stops making, innovations. But the question is that I honestly feel that electrical vehicles are not the answer. The amount of emissions that are created in merely extracting lithium for the batteries itself goes into the millions of tons, you know? So, I mean, it's really not that green as we think it is. We just, our own conscious by saying, hey, I'm being green. I'm riding an electric car. I'm not polluting the thing. But that's really not true. So that's why that's not my go-to or my final solution. I honestly think that hydrogen is the final solution or the more better solution. But again, that's a layman's thing.
Well, it'll be interesting to see how President Biden's plan works out. $2 trillion
investment. The government of India this year has recognized the importance of hydrogen. And in the budget, they've announced the hydrogen mission, which I think is a very timely and important thing to do. And I think governments have to get together and put in a few $100 billion and put their best brains on the job in a joint project, because this affects everybody. It's not that climate change affects India or China or America. It affects everybody. So I think everyone should join in and put in their best brains more than anything else. Bill, you had a comment?
Yes, thank you. My comment also, I agree with you on the hydrogen. I think every house should have a fuel cell. Every business should have a fuel cell. But I think in the meantime, the solid state battery is going to do wonders for the interim. Mm-hmm. This transitional time when we go between. But anyway, yes, hydrogen is the step in the future.
I also said that this is a great interim or, you know, transitional solution, but not the final solution. Electric batteries are not going to be the final solution. They require too much extraction, too much minerals, too many rare earths and everything to really be a final solution.
Well, it's like you said, we're still making the energy the same form, and that's through smoke.
Coal or the same. So it's just shifting it from the tailpipe to the smokestack. That's all. You're not really doing much more than that. If there aren't any other questions, I'd like to move to the next topic if we have the time, Colonel. President Saab?
Go ahead. Please go ahead. Yeah.
Another few minutes?
I think Vikram has a question.
Vikram had a question, I think.
Go ahead.
Yeah. All right. Tony, thanks. I think that nuclear power is probably the best transitional the solution that we have at this time. It's good for 50 to 70 years once it's set up. It's highly compact. The cost per megawatt generated is extremely low. It is probably fueled once in a lifetime. And the disposal challenge, which is what everybody is talking about. I mean, if you take all the nuclear power plants in the world and you talk about disposal of waste over 50 years of generation, that will probably fill one football field. I know it's a problem, but it can be tackled. It's, you know, the sheer volume of it is, it's possible to tackle. So I believe that maybe the best transition, a blueprint for transition to hydrogen or better fuel, and I absolutely agree, and I have always believed, even for the last, you know, 25, 30 years, that the hydrogen fuel cell is the technology that needs to be, pushed. But there is also one other thing, that the transmission of power, and we stand to lose, countries like India stand to lose almost 10 to 15% of all power generated. And that's a very significant number. That's almost, you know, the carbon footprint from that 15% loss of power generated is almost equal to the carbon footprint that we are generating from maybe our two-wheelers or our cars. So these are the two areas I would like to know what you believe, because nuclear power is a big bogey, and the bogeyman keeps saying that, you know, this is highly dangerous and it's a big problem. But we've only had one major nuclear disaster, and that was probably because the Soviets just didn't, you know, they cut a lot of corners there in Chernobyl. What do you think?
I personally feel that nuclear power is, you know, has got a very bad rap and a very, very, you know, not in a right way. I don't think it's justified, very unjustified rap. As I said, you know, the number of people who died out of nuclear disasters is much lower than the number of people who died out of, disasters with non-nuclear power plants. But the political problem on getting people to, you know, get into nuclear power again, get back into it and create better power. In fact, you know, if you read the latest Economist, it has because of the 10th anniversary of Fukushima, you know, they've got a very nice article on nuclear power. And that's exactly what they're saying, that what you said just now, Vikram, that's the next best thing to happen and probably needs to be done properly with better regulation rather than just being thrown, you know, you're throwing the baby out with the bathwater by stopping nuclear, construction. And the only two countries which are actually doing it, by the way, are China and Russia. So eventually they'll be able to make things cheaper and we'll all have to buy our nuclear plants from them rather than, you know, from other countries who might be better to deal with, i.e. the US, UK, India, etc., democratic countries. Somebody had a... Okay, so may I go to the next thing?
Yes.
A thing that keeps irking me a lot, and I just want to.
Mukesh, may I interrupt over here for a moment?
Please.
Okay. Now, see, when we talk of nuclear power, we are always discussing fission power, and fission power has its problem because of disposal of waste and emissions and things like that. But the ultimate solution to energy is the fusion power, nuclear fusion power. That's clean power, has no emissions, has no waste to take care of, and it is unlimited. Eventually, and like I said, unfortunately, we never discuss that power at all. Obviously, we are a couple of decades away from that. But once that happens, then all these energy problems will eventually come to an end, I believe.
The problem... is that, Sandeep, that we don't have those two decades. By the time all this comes in, we're going to be, the 450 parts per million will have been crossed and we'll really be facing disaster. So we really need some things that can be done within the next 3 to 5 years. Honestly, that's my, while I agree with you that fusion is the final answer as far as nuclear power is concerned. But, you know, right now the technology is so, it needs... really, it needs a new Manhattan project to look into nuclear, hydrogen, and DAC, direct air capture. These are the three things that we need to do if we are to solve this problem within the time period or the 10, 15 years that we have left at the current rates of emission.
Yes, I do agree with you on that, Mukesh. But sometimes, you know, miracles happen and technology changes miraculously fast.
तुम्हारे
so, just keep our fingers crossed. You never know. Thanks so much.
तुम्हारे में घी शक्त है. So, yeah. You know, I know that Rotary, we are not supposed to talk politics, but I'm not talking politics. When I'm talking about our electoral system, I'm talking something which is apolitical. It's more civic or social in nature, which I want all of you gentlemen and ladies to ruminate. There's nothing political or partisan in this matter. Let me start by saying that as per our constitution that we gave ourselves, India is supposed to be a representative democracy. It's not a direct democracy, it's a representative democracy. This means that our MPs or MLAs who represent us in parliament or in assemblies represent the majority of the citizens of their constituents. But if you actually look at it, the reality is completely otherwise. We have blindly followed the Westminster British system of elections without applying our minds as to how the system of first past the post being declared the winner has created a glaring distortion in our representative democracy. This system is okay in a country like UK or USA, where you have two main parties. The winner has by logic or mathematics to be the person who gets 50% or more of the votes cast. However, in a multi-party system like ours, where there are 20, 30, 40 parties, the winner rarely, if ever, gets 50% plus one of the vote. Most candidates are elected having won only less than 25% of the votes cast. Even the most popular politicians get 30 to 35%. In other words, the majority of the constituents have voted against the person who wins and who's supposed to be our representative. How can such a person claim to be the people's representative when 70, 80% of the voters have voted against him? You know, it's a well-known fact in political circles that you're assured of victory in an election if you can garner upwards of 22 to 25% of the votes. This has led to what is popularly known and, you know, pejoratively known as a vote bank politics system in our country, where these politicians exploit the weakness in the system and focus on wooing that one section or constituency which forms this percentage of 18, 20, 22%, whether it is by caste, by religion, by language, by, you know, by class, whatever, any other common grouping, any other identity. No politician is required to win the vote and favor of or make his policies to benefit the larger section of the population of at least 50% or more. In fact, politicians cynically exploit the system by setting up two or three fake candidates who have no chance whatsoever of winning the vote, but act as vote siphons because they siphon away the opposing candidate's votes and hence give the main candidate or the guy who wants to win the largest vote and he wins the election. The downside of the systems are there for all of us to see and suffer. Casteist, religion-based parties and candidates now form the bulk of those seeking elections and the overall majority of the population overlooked and left to suffer on their own. The point of this is that with given India's size, diversity, and social structure, it predisposes it to personality politics, one where issue-based policy differences play second fiddle. In India, complicated loyalties in a highly differentiated system refracted by caste, class, and religion make it very difficult for political parties to have a US-style primaries-based politics without alienating the groups that lose out in internal polls. That's the reason why neither Congress nor BJP nor any party has a primary-based system of leadership selection. To put it differently, a factionalized society operating with a first-past-the-post electoral system creates a constant crisis of representation. It is not geared to yield a politics that forges unity and consensus as each group looks out only for its own interests. To rectify this intolerable situation may be almost impossible because it involves and requires the support of the politicians and to whose interest it is contrary. They need to change the laws and they're the beneficiaries of this current system. So I don't see how they're going to do it. But my you know, two-bit solution is that we should change our system to make it a two-round system. The first round can be as we have it now, where all parties and candidates are in the fray. If in the first round, any candidate gets majority, that's 50% plus one of the votes cast, the election ends there. However, as is more likely, if no one gets 50%, then the candidates with the largest and the second largest number of votes should have a runoff. Obviously, one of them will get 50% or plus, and he will be the winner. This will prevent or mitigate, I would say, vote bank politics, which is the bane of our system. And it can be avoided as every candidate will need to you know, cater to and appeal to more than just a small vote bank. He'll have to cater to at least 50% of the population to get reelected, have to have policies or support those policies which support more than 50% of the population to get reelected. So this is something that we need to do. I know it's going to involve greater costs and stuff like that. And maybe there are better systems. You know, there is proportional representation like they have in Europe or in Germany, and we can study those. But definitely our first past the post system, where the person who gets the largest number of votes cast wins and becomes the candidate and becomes your so-called representative of the people, when he represents only a minority of the people, is absolutely the wrong thing for our country. And it has created too many disparities and too much, sort of all this that you see today, the bad part of politics that we see today, you can trace it down to this first past the post electoral system. And one of the main things is that, apart from, of course, the fact that our people are so you know, gullible as to fall for all these kind of policies. So I want to raise some sort of social and civic thought amongst our members. And, you know, think about this, think of what it does, think of what we could do. I don't have all the solutions. I don't have this thing, but this is something that has been bothering me and irking me for many years. And I have actually been planning to do some research. I've appointed some kids from law college and other colleges to give me facts and figures. And then I want to go in with a public interest litigation to the Supreme Court so that the Supreme Court asks the government or instructs the government to look into the fact that whether any of the people in the parliament actually represent the majority of their constituents or not. And if not, then to create a system whereby they actually do. This is what I'd like to happen, but I'd like, you know, this to be a conversation amongst all of us. And I just wanted to provoke your mind into this thought, because I don't think many of us think of these things or think of this aspect of our electoral system. You know, we think of many other things about politics, but we don't think of this, you know, very critical aspect of our system, which I think is the root cause of a lot of our problems. Not all of them, but a lot of them. Thank you very much. Any comments, any suggestions? I'd love to take. I want to hear our members say what they think about it.
Indeed, it's fast provoking, and I'm expecting a lot many questions from the participants.
Obviously, I haven't provoked them enough.
Or we are probably stunned into silence with the simplicity of it all.
Think of it. I mean, I'm putting this out for everyone to think, to ruminate and decide. What do you think? I mean, do you think today the person who represents our constituency actually represents the majority of the people? He got into 27% of the votes. 73% voted against him. Come on. How can you be representative of them? Yes, UK, please.
Yeah. So, do you then solicit that there should be two-party system like America has, so there will be a simple representation to one of the parties as majority?
This is the
simplest solution of the problem what you are describing.
See, in a very, very diverse country like ours, UK, my thinking is that in a diverse country like ours, you can't have just two parties. We do have the need for more parties, because we have 22 different languages, different, you know, kinds of backgrounds, different ways we think. So I really think, you know, and then within our thing, there's the castes, the subdivided and all that. So I think a multiplicity of parties is not the problem. It is the fact that our system calls for only one round of elections, rather than, you know, by means by which we can get a majority to elect the person who goes to parliament. That's my personal opinion. I may be wrong, but this is what I said. I want more thoughts, more comments, more this thing to think about. What could possibly be the various situations, solutions to this situation? It is definitely something that we need to think about. And I, as I said, I'm waiting for a good Chief Justice to come who's not sold to one political party or the other before I go in for a PIL on this very issue.
May I say something?
Please.
Prerna here, hi. So you're talking about people coming in. What we saw in the last election, I had someone from the family who was standing for the elections at the local level, basically. It's not just the people voting, it is the parties who are so intermingled like one party paid off the other party a huge sum of money to change the person who is standing from there and not give him a ticket. So this is not just at the local level, this goes right up to the national level. Everybody is interlinked and everybody is paying each other. You know, the person who pays maximum money is the one who gets to stand, and the other party decides who is standing from party B. So it's just a game of money, power and politics that's going on right now.
That's what I just said, Prerna, that our system creates these kind of loopholes or creates this kind of situation where this can be exploited. If we didn't have that first past the post, highest number of vote kind of system, this could not be done. This would not happen. There would be a more fair and free election.
But if you can't select your own candidate who's standing, the other party selects your candidate. So that's where the corruption starts.
To an extreme, but I suppose, I mean, somewhere or the other, we got to start.
We do. We definitely do.
Remember, we're only 70 years old. Other democracies are 200 years old. And I think at the time when they were 60, 70 years old, they had as much skullduggery in their politics as we have today. So it's not that, you know, I think it's the learning curve. And I think the only thing is that we need to have enough public interest and public demand for change and improvement and to correct our systems, you know, step by step or in some ways so that we get to a better, more fair, more, you know, equitable electoral system rather than the one we have today.
Definitely. Which is certainly not.
You know, an answer to it. We chose the wrong system, honestly.
May I ask the question? Tony, I think the need for a change is very clear, no question. The current system has got too many holes in it. Essentially, what happens is maybe 50 or 60% of the electorate comes out to vote. There are maybe 8 or 10 candidates. The guy who wins with the majority probably gets about 10 or 15% of the vote cast, which is maybe just 8% of the total vote or the total voters there.
I was being generous by saying 20% and 30%.
Yeah, so it's only 8 or 9%. Now, the problem with the runoff system that you proposed, one of the problems I can think of is that only the first and second guy have to be in the runoff. Now, both of these guys, would have got 8% of the vote, the other guy would have got maybe 5% of the vote. That's why they are first and second. And they still don't represent the electorate. Now, the problem is when the runoff takes place, you are giving the electorate only two choices, you know, bad or worse. So, actually, the guy who got 2% might be the one, you know, who might get, if he was one of the two candidates, he might be the one. Because a 50-50 election or a 50-50 selection actually is not much of a selection. It either tells you to say yes or no, and you can't go for a maybe or a third or a fourth option. And that sort of takes away some part of the free election. I'm not against what you're proposing, but I'm just saying this is one of the pitfalls of that system.
And Vikram, my counter to that or my thought on that is that in order to get elected, you know, if you have this kind of system, the candidates will know that in order to get elected, they have to appeal or they have to look after the interests of more than just one small block of constituents. You have to look after half the population. You have to mold your policies, your statements, your election campaign and everything to actually, you know, cater to larger number of people. Otherwise, you're not going to get that 50% vote. There are weaknesses in this system also. That's why I said, I just wanted to throw this thought. This was my thinking, but I wanted to throw this thought that we need to change this first past the post system where, you know, a person who gets maybe 8% of the votes or 5% of the votes becomes the so-called representative of the people, which is not what the constitution framers, you know, sort of actually thought they were doing when they framed the constitution, when they said that we should be a representative.
I agree with all of that. But my concern is that when we go into a runoff, the guy who would have been elected with 8% of the vote, and therefore we are going into the runoff because he's got only 8% of the vote. The guy who would have got elected with 8% and the guy who would have got elected with 6%, they are the only two horses in that race. And therefore one of them is going to win. So whether a 6% guy wins or an 8% guy wins, simply because there are no other candidates, may not solve the problem.
Good point. Good point. But I mean, I'd love to see if there are other better solutions to our situation. You know,
the big problem is the quality of people who are trying to enter public life. I mean, what Prerna mentioned is an exception. I have friends who came back from the US, right, for 10 years to get into electoral politics and discovered that it's a closed system. You cannot get into electoral politics and win at this point of time. So I think, I mean, we are now supporting this Indian School of Democracy and so many other initiatives. So I think it'll take a couple of generations for people who deserve to be in public life to come into public life. In that time, we'll have to be content with 20% decent people, 80% thugs.
As I said that, you know, we are part of that learning curve at 70 years old. We are very young compared to the 250-year-old. And look at what happened in America. I mean, you know, even being a 250-year-old democracy, they screwed up so badly this time. They almost didn't have, a proper democracy. So, so what the hell? But what I'm trying to say is that I think we need to have more discourse on this issue, more public participation in this issue, so that some workable solution can be thought of. Right now, there's no discourse at all. Nobody's even thinking about it. And it serves the politicians not to raise this at all because they are the beneficiaries of that. They only need to get 8-10% of the vote and to become your overlords. They're not servants of the people. They're the masters of the people once they get elected. They're only servants of the people and they come to you to ask you for your vote. I think we're running out of time. Colonel?
No, still 5 minutes are there. One more question can be there, if anybody interested.
Anything, anyone? Julia, by the way, my attorney in New York is a guy called Adam Kaufman. So I have a very close relationship with the Kaufman family or the Kaufman clan.
I keep wishing I was part of the Kaufman family that owns the big retail store. Unfortunately, I'm not.
Well. But he's really a gem of a guy, and when you can say that about a lawyer in America, I think that's saying a lot.
For sure. Does he spell his name with two F's?
Yes.
So if no question, I am proceeding further. So before going for inviting Rotarian Vikram Puri for extending formal vote of thanks, I would like to welcome once again President Julia and Bill and Prashant who have joined today as a esteemed guest. So thank you very much. Stay connected. We will be sending the Zoom invite link, and if you are interested, you please join. Thank you very much once again. So not taking much time now, I would like to invite Rotary Vikram Puri, Honorable Advisory Board Member, Rotary Club of Pune Riverside, for extending formal vote of thanks to Rotarian Mukesh Malhotra and other participants. Over to Vikramji.
So Mukesh, thank you. I see that Colonel Mishra has failed in his attempt to give me only 1 minute at the end of the meeting to give to.
No, no, you take your time. Take your time.
He tried very hard to get another question, but they were not forthcoming. But I think the first part of the first part of your talk was absolutely on the ball. You've identified the problem, and I think you identified some potential solutions as well. I think that gives everybody lots of food for thought. But I, as I said, I personally believe that nuclear is the transition technology. Nothing is going to come into nothing is going to come into being in the next 5 to 15 years or 5 to 20 years, which is the time period that we really need to act in to address the problem. And nuclear works really well because of that. And we don't have better technology. The second issue is that, this whole thing about electric vehicles and clean energy, we need to all remember what you said was absolutely right. In fact, every electric car, to my mind, creates as much of a carbon footprint as a fossil fuel powered car or near to that. Simply because the only advantage that it has is that it's replacing the directly delivered fossil fuel, and therefore the logistics cost of fuel delivery, that carbon footprint is being saved. So I think you raised some really valid points there. And of course, the most important one, which is that we are in a, you know, we are in a stage where we sort of believe everything we hear more negative than positive. And nuclear power is a victim of that. Nuclear energy is clean. It's safe. It's safer than, you know, most other forms of energy, especially when you consider the perils and dangers of mining, because when you run thermal power plants, all of that coal comes out of mining, and the kind of pollution and the, you know, in addition to the carbon footprint that that generates is a huge number, in addition to degrading the natural resources of the earth. So thank you for that. I think you've opened our minds to that. As far as the second,
Yeah, please go ahead.
As far as your second talk on the electoral system is concerned, without a shadow of doubt, we need something better, something more transparent, and something more representative. I think in the absence of any other better idea, this might be a good one. But my fear is that the Indian politician is, you know, he has a thin skin only when somebody criticizes him in the newspaper or on social media. And that's the time he runs to the police station, files FIRs, and does all those kind of shenanigans, accuses people of sedition when you criticize, you know, his form of governance. But when it comes to elections, he has a very, very thick skin. So he doesn't care. He knows that if there is a runoff and there is only one other candidate, it's either a question of he getting paid or him paying, like Prerna said. The quantum of money that changes hands is huge. And the big risk, especially maybe perhaps some underdeveloped, and I don't say that in terms of economic, but in terms of politically underdeveloped states, that might be a huge problem. And you might actually have seats being sold, because now there are no more contenders. There's only one guy to be negotiated with. Either he will, pay you, or he will get paid. And that might pose a bigger danger. That said, I think you've raised a very, very important point, and this is probably one of the ways to resolve it, if we can build in checks and safeguards to avoid these kind of problems, you know, where there are only two people left in the fray. So thank you very much. It was a very informative morning, and I think lots of us were, forced to think about where we stand on various issues. And these are two very crucial issues. So thank you, Tony. And thank you, everybody else, for joining us on this meeting this morning, this Wednesday morning. Have a great day.
Thank you, Vikram. You have another, role of honor. You have to share thought of the week. So I invite you for that. Over to you again.
I don't know what to say, a thought for the day or thought for the week. But when you start, especially for Tony, that, you know, don't hesitate to, shoot for the moon every time, because if you miss, you'll just hit a star. So just go for it. I think go for this change that you want to bring about, and keep talking to people. I think they'll throw up lots of options, alternatives. So just go for it. Shoot for the moon. If you miss, you'll just hit a star.
Thank you very much. So I will like to invite Lieutenant Sandeep Vaisji for Tanika of the Day, which is cracking the joke. So over to Sandeep Ji. Sandeep Ji, are you there?
Sorry, I forgot to unmute myself. Good morning and thank you. So it's kind of a one-liner. It says, never argue about climate change. It always turns into a heated debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. the last thing which I have announcement is next week keynote speaker is Naren Goidwani, founder Life School and Keep Moving Movement, on the topic, You Light the Little Lamp. Hundreds sun will light. This is the topic which he has chosen very carefully, and he's going to speak, which is going to be very interesting, and that on coming Wednesday, 17th March 2021. at 8:30 a.m. I invite you all to please block day, date, and time and join. So thank you very much. Stay healthy, happy, safe, and blessed. And allow me to end the meeting. And before end the meeting, I would like to extend my heartfelt thank to Mukesh ji. And as you know, this is the experiment which we are doing. Our own members are rocking and much, much better than the speakers we are inviting. Those are really very good, very stunning, very wonderful, no doubt about it. But nonetheless, our own members are really delivering the talk, which is thought-provoking and very interesting. So next month also, we will coming with one of the power-packed Riversider. I am looking for that. I am contacting. So do I have the permission to end the meeting? Mukesh ji? Should I end the meeting? Friends, thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Good day. Sir. Good day.